So my name is Raghu, and I'm going to be talking about Aesop and how you could use it for creating tiered data sources. So Aesop is a system that I created. It's joint work with a number of engineers from Flipkart. So the way we'll probably go around with this talk is, first you'll be wondering is, well, why should you even be interested in this? So I'll try to see if you can relate to a number of examples that we'll have in the first few minutes. So once you get interested, then we'll see the kind of scenarios that Aesop can fit in, and probably how it can be useful for you, okay? Okay, we'll start with this very common question, right? So what data store, and the what data store question comes up in a number of places. So let's take a few examples. Okay, how many of you have heard this? Okay, most likely in what situations? Interviews? Yeah, so when I hear this, I always wonder that, you know, folks like Facebook and Twitter probably don't have good engineers. They need to go and find better engineers because they still use SQL or relational systems, right? So you always have this or saying attribute scale to wanting to use a NoSQL database, right? And then when you get to a further choice about the access type, right? Do you want very point lookups? Are you trying to do range scans? You're trying to have very flexible schema. Then you decide between a number of data stores, which is probably relational, key value, document, or let's say columnar. Also, when you hit scaling limits of single node databases, you realize that, yeah, all of my data can't fit in a single node database. And then guess what? You get to conferences like this and probably a few others, and people claim that they have you know, the best solution for all your problems. And just the last talk by Shalin, who told you that probably not all of that is necessarily true. Some of it is true, but not all of it, right? And benchmarks on distributed data stores. Rise of memory-based and really flash-optimized stores. So when you hear about someone saying we are flash-optimized and they're talking about using log-structured data storage formats, so you need that they're talking. You know that they're talking about something serious, because with flash, they're even leveraging. Obviously, they're trying to address cases like peer leveling and making sure that they don't have too many of in-place updates. And cap trade-offs been discussed a lot in this conference, so you're always trying to trade off consistency, availability, and probably the entire spectrum in between. A few other considerations like durability of data, how durable you want the data, disk to memory ratios, how much of data can you hold in memory. When they say it's super fast, but guess what, you have to hold all of that data in memory. When you have large data sets, that's not affordable to you, and you're looking for a trade-off where you can have very large or reasonably larger disk to memory ratios. Right, and as scale really grows, you're also thinking about size of single cluster that you can operate. So all of this is leading to these kind of questions of what data store should you use, and is there a single answer? Quite unlikely, right? So let's take an example of let's say scaling an e-commerce website, and I'm from Flipkart, so let's take the Flipkart example. So this was Flipkart, and we can't see too much, but it wasn't nothing great there, but this was in 2007. So how were we? We had a single MySQL instance, and we were sending all our reads and writes to the same instance, right? So that wasn't scaling. So we, like anyone else, we also moved to doing our reads from a slave and had MySQL replication going. We also had analytic reads going of the same slave. That wasn't working, and then therefore we had more slaves, right? So one dedicated for online reads and another one for analytical reads. So very common pattern. All of us would have seen that, right? Now in this, what we did, I don't know whether we did it consciously, but over time we realized that we had traded consistency for availability, right? And higher performance. Now let's just fast forward to something like what is Flipkart today. So this is how our persistence looks like, right? So user session is a combination of memcached. We have HBase as its backend. We have the product or the entire catalog data, which is coming from HBase, Elastic, and Redis. Cart is MySQL and Mongo. Notifications is HBase. Search is Solr, Neo4j. Recommendation is they're generated in Hadoop MR and served out of Redis or Aerospike. And promotions, which is currently getting rolled out, is, let's say, HBase and Redis. So in all of this, a very common pattern that's emerging is there is a source of truth data store, and then there is a serving layer that's fronting it, right? Again, a very common pattern that many of us would have seen. So I'll take another example of, because it's tiered data, so we'll take another example of scaling payments, right? So the Flipkart payments data store has a relational set of tables which stores all of the online interactions with the merchant, the amount to be charged. So these are just a set of tables, like a transaction master, transaction summary, transaction sale detail, and so on, which has the, it also stores all interactions with the bank, the responses that it has got, very, very normalized. We also need a denormalized database where we can use for consoles for handling refunds and so on. And why denormalized? Because the, as the size of transactions increases, we can't keep all of the data on the online and the live database, right? And as it grows, we have other use cases, data flows. We also have an archive DB, which is for regulatory requirements. We need to keep a copy of all of those transactions that are there in the online database for a few years, right? And sorry, we also have another analytics and reporting database, which is used, again, for doing reports and queries. So clearly, in this case, so data needs to flow pretty much on an everyday, near real-time basis, continuously, and in a very reliable manner, right? And there are multiple ways that one can think of doing it, which is, okay, you write data to, okay, let's take the most simplest way you can do it, right? So you have the MySQL DB. You can write a nightly cron or a periodically running cron, which extracts data, so essentially an ETL kind of a job, and then inserts data into your secondary store, right? Now then you deal with partitions, and when I say partitions, not like the Jepson partition, but MySQL partitions, and you keep probably dropping those partitions. Now, all the other approaches, you always do a dual write, where you write into your online database and also write into an archive or a secondary data store. Now, any of us here would realize that the problem with that is it's very, very hard to get it right always, right? Because you're talking about writes happening across two threads of executions. You want to have, if you want both of them to be transactional, then you're talking about distributed transactions and trying to get two-phase commits and so on, right? So that's not possible. But if you go that way, you're obviously going to miss a few writes. So what happens with this kind of a data consistency in polyglot persistence? So let's look at some of the caching or serving layer challenges. Interestingly, that happens to be one of the two hardest problems in computer science, right? So what happens with cache invalidation? So why should cache invalidation be such a big issue? So let's take a look at some of the caching strategies, right? So you have, very often you have a very lazy caching strategy where you have an empty cache which comes up, and then as user requests come in, you start lazy loading the cache from the primary data store, right? A very, very common pattern to do that. Now, you've loaded data into it. Now, what do you do for data freshness? You say that, okay, let me now set TTLs on the cache, right? And if you want reasonably consistent or consistency to be catching up reasonably fast, you go and set low TTLs. That's fair. And now what happens? Let's take a case where, let's say in an e-commerce site, you're doing a flash sale for a product and there is sudden interest in one particular product and all requests start landing up. Right. So, and take the case where, let's say, that data is not held in memory. What happens? It exposes, it creates the thundering herd issue, right? So all requests coming and possibly hitting the same node, and all of them finally going and trying to read data from the primary data store, and the primary data store, its own vulnerability or around availability gets exposed, right? So if you look at a data store like MySQL, in most cases, it's a highly consistent data store, but it's not really known for availability. Right, so it exposes that construct or that constraint from the DB, right? So that's a caching problem. Now, let's say you have a cache size. So if you're talking about a few thousands of items, you can probably size it and fit it into memory on a physical machine. But what do you do if you have about 25 or 30 million items that you're selling in the catalog? You obviously can't fit all of that into memory. So you have a cache size. You're also always trying to size your cache in a way that you can keep most of the recently accessed data in memory, right? And also distribution. And why do you distribute? Again, to scale the number of reads. There's only so much number of reads that you can serve out of a single node, right? So you can probably get up to, say, 20K, 30K kind of transactions per second. What happens if it goes beyond that? So it means that you need multiple copies. And if you have multiple copies and multiple replicas, it kind of rules out even any write-through mechanisms that you can have, right? You can say that, oh, I'll have a write-behind strategy. So how many replicas do you update? And if you have n number of replicas, you're trying to update, and if updates to a few of them fail, then what do you do with the transaction? Do you fail the transaction? You're back to the problem of the same thing around distributed transactions, right? So all of this makes even write-through mechanisms hard to implement if you're trying to maintain consistency. So bottom line, serving layer is eventually consistent at best. So why do we say at best? Because this happens only if all of your replicas eventually get all of its updates, right? And when you say eventual, today I've also seen people mention strong eventual consistency. Eventual consistency itself means that you basically got all of the millions of updates that you're probably making on that system, right? You can probably have weak consistency, but eventually consistency means that you need to ensure that all replicas get the data. So a little bit more on eventual consistency. What it simply says that if you have multiple replicas of data, they basically converge over time. It doesn't time box it or doesn't time bound it in any way. What are the pros? So you can scale reads through multiple replicas, right? It gives you higher overall data availability, because even if some replicas fail or an entire replica sets fail, you can still serve partial amounts of data. The cons are reads return live data before convergence. So what this means that because the replicas can be at various stages of convergence, they always return data till what they have really seen at that point in time, right? So it means that they're just returning live data. So it's quite possible that a user goes to a page, he sees a data from one replica, which probably says value X, and the next request, for some reason, because it's all load balance, goes to another replica and probably sees another value, right? That's because just simply the replicas haven't received all of the updates. Okay, even achieving eventual consistency is not easy, right? Trivially, it requires that at least once delivery guarantees exist. And you need to ensure that that happens to updates across all replicas. And now, depending on how you implement eventual consistency, very often, a relatively easier approach is trying to sequence or order the updates rather than trying to deliver out-of-order messages, right? And when you say out-of-order messages, at the receiving side, the consumer or the receiving replica should exhibit properties or should exhibit commutative properties, right? So it doesn't matter if you're saying an increment decrement or a decrement increment of a value changes in the order of the way they are delivered, you still get the database or the data store to become hold the same value, right? So even just getting at least once delivery guarantee is not easy. So what's Aesop? And this is the kind of problem that it aims to solve. And again, because the examples that I gave you, both in terms of the cache update or, for that matter, the payments database, they are real and present problems that we faced, and therefore went and looked at building something, which is essentially a change data capture and propagation system, right? So it can detect change and basically propagate changes to the various copies of that data. So what does it look like? So there are three parts. So there's a producer part, there is a relay, and there are a set of consumers, right? So producers, we currently work with MySQL and HP, support both of them. Basically, these are data stores which support some kind of a transaction log, right? A write-ahead log of what's getting written. So those write-ahead logs, I'll come to that part about how it works, get picked up, they get played into a relay. A relay is nothing but a memory map file. It's a ring buffer containing all of the updates that happened on the respective data store, and also maintains subscriptions from multiple consumers, right? And your consumers themselves are subscribers, which can be running at very different rates. So the register on the relay They get the data delivered to them, they transform a map, and then you can go and update a number of different destinations, right? So fundamentally, this is, it's a very, very, I mean, at the overall pattern, this looks very much like a pub sub, right? So there are a producer and consumer. So what's in this, if you notice, there is a thing that we can have data originating in MySQL, but probably eventually delivered to Redis, right? Or it can be something that's coming out of HBase and can be delivered into, let's say, even to Kafka. Okay, so the approach that it takes is log mining. So is log mining really old wine and new bottle? To some extent, yes. That's because folks like Stonebreaker, you know who he is, the Turing Award winner and creator of OldDB and a number of other databases. So he and a couple of others wrote this paper about the architecture of a database in 2007, a very good read. So I happened to read that, and I would encourage all to read. And there it mentions that durability in a database is typically implemented via logging and recovery, right? So that simple log, which we always, as application programmers, always thought was you write for debug messages. No, in a very different world, it serves a very different and very important purpose, that of data recovery and persistence. More recently, Jay Kreps, the creator of Kafka, famously said that the contents of a DB are just a cache of the latest records in a log. The log is a source of truth, and while the database is just a subset of the log. So all of us who are here, and I did hear mention of Kafka multiple times in this conference, and all of us really like Kafka for various reasons, right? So obviously it's a very reliable and useful piece of software, and the creator probably has got this right. So what's so special about the write-ahead log? What it ensures is, it basically ensures that every modification is flushed to disk. So it's not like in the Jepsen test example that you saw, you have n replicas, data not getting written to disk and probably losing updates. So with a write-ahead log, so every modification is flushed to disk, and all modifications are maintained in order. So which still means that, okay, pretty much you can use the log. So Aesop essentially uses that, and in terms to just critique the kind of consistency model that Aesop supports, this is a consistency model map from the Jepsen website. So it's by Kyle Kingsbury. I mean, those of you who are there with on Challenge Talk will know. So it basically lays out the various consistency models map that exists, and the strongest being ones at the top, and the more weaker ones being towards the bottom, right? So if you say you have a read committed, so that is something which is low on consistency but high on availability. Now, strict consistency, like linearizability, for example, is too hard and requires coordination across replicas, right? So what does linearizability say? It says that if you execute a write, the next read across any of the replicas will return the same result. Now, you just think about trying to implement that. It's like super hard, right? So even system that probably got close to it, like Google Spanner, right? No wonder they were looking for, you know, atomic clocks and GPS synchronized clocks and the whole thing to just get the clocks synchronized, because it relies on absolute global time. You take a more less strict one, which can, if you have in a distributed database, you can have replicas which can disagree forever, right? Updates did not reach at all. And the worst part is, very often you can say, yeah, I can replay the data, but you can replay the data only when you know what you have lost. Typically, it happens that you lose a few updates across millions of updates. So that's not so bad if you know what you lost. And very often you don't know what you've lost, and that's where the problem comes, right? So how do you know, how do you really trust that data store in terms of the replica, right? So if you look at sequential consistency, and that's highlighted there, so all that sequential consistency says is, it says nothing about time. There is no reference to the most recent write operation. It just simply says that all of the data that is passed on to the replicas is ordered, and it is delivered in the same sequence of occurrence, right? Now, an implementation mechanism for this would be basically primary-based replication protocols. So essentially what Aesop does is basically follows this, and when we say that we can listen into the transaction logs of MySQL or HBase, basically what it does is the Aesop process runs as a participating replica, as a participating slave in a cluster. So for the MySQL master, this looks like a MySQL slave. For a HBase cluster, this looks like a HBase region server. Right? So then you can tap into the whole replication protocol and basically use that to deliver data. So what about reliable delivery, right? So that's where we started. The whole premise of the talk was, how do you ensure reliability? So if you look at the data store, and now that we say that it has a transaction log, so everything is flushed to disk, so you see that there are writes, whatever, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, happening in order, and it's there in the log. So in the producer, so the Aesop producer is basically a slave or replica of the same transaction log, so the data is being delivered to it. It does a transformation and stores it into the ring buffer, and at the same time, it's also checkpointing the offset in the replication log, in the bin log. So in case of MySQL, what we do is basically that offset or the checkpoint, we call in this, it's called a system change number, which is a monotonically increasing number, which is nothing but a long computed from the bin log number and the offset of the record inside that bin log. Okay, so that checkpoint is stored either in a file system or in Zookeeper. We'll come to where else we use Zookeeper. Similarly, on the subscribers N2, they're receiving various number of updates. All of them store similar checkpoints in a same or the similar data store. So those of us who have used, let's say, Kafka know that the clients are supposed to hold on to offsets, right? Store offsets and then go and resume from those offsets. This is very, very similar, right? It's just the offset computing mechanism changes between data stores. So for MySQL, again, like we said, it's the file number and the offset. We have also implemented an SCA generator which can take care of mastership transfer changes, right? So if you promote a hot standby to a master, then obviously the bin log offset may not necessarily remain the same, right? So we have implemented something that can take care of such transfer scenarios. And in case of HBase, there's nothing like an offset inside the validates, but we compute it based on the timestamp of the validate and some more seeding of data to make it monotonically increasing, right? So the SCN compute basically differs between these different data stores. And subscribers, of course, after they write to the destination store, they can go and store the offset. And that's how it maintains reliable delivery. And what this helps is, even if the points of failure, right? If the relay were to go down, if the subscriber were to go down, it doesn't matter, because when they come, they always resume from that offset. Okay, so with that, you can kill nodes, you can bring them back on. We have not gone and run tests like the Jepsen test, because none of this, if you see the destination data stores, they are as consistent, or the quality that they exhibit is left to that data store, right? So if you say Elasticsearch loses data in certain scenarios, it will continue to lose. But what Aesop just ensures is it ensures that the data that was there from a source system is delivered to a destination, and that is based on these offsets. So even if you went and mucked around with IP tables, or if you went and changed the timestamp, the SCN is not derived from that. Right, so if you went and changed the offset in the DB and then you went and played around, that I don't think is a network partition kind of a simulation, right? That's like someone really seriously trying to mess around with it, right? And what this, and if you see the guarantee, it tries to ensure there is an at least once delivery guarantee, so which means that the destination data stores also exhibit some characteristics of idempotency. Right, so the destination store. So what we have done in many of our, even when we went into production in some of these systems, if we for any reason think that when there was a bug and data was not delivered, we just simply reset the offset to probably a day prior and just rerun the whole set of data. Right, so that replayability is important. And probably the characteristic of it being that you can replay from a specific point in time is important. Okay. So rather than, in this case, try to solve for saying the system will not fail, we would rather deal with saying that what happens when the system fails and how can you recover from that, right? And I think that is a more practical approach in a, when you're working with distributed systems. So on the event consumption side, this is all some sugarcoating that we do. If you think that you don't want to write code and you want to consume data from MySQL and say, write to Elasticsearch or write to Kafka or let's say HBase, right? You don't need to write code. You can just write mapping configurations. The underlying libraries map it and update your destination store, right? So you can basically define, it's a kind of a simple mapping where you say what is the source, what is the destination. You can apply some transformations. You can do some grouping. I won't go into too much of specific, but yeah, you can do all of that. You can also do multiple mappings, right? Our payments data store, for example, we use the same stream to write both into our denormalized MySQL instance as well as to HBase. It's the same relay, just that the consumers are two separately mapped consumers. On the consumption, we also support clustering. Now, you might wonder why you think that producer is the one that needs clustering, so why are we doing clustering on the consumer side? If you really look at it from a workload characteristic, the producer is just simply tailing the write-ahead log, right? So if you really see the speed at which it can operate, even a single threaded process can operate at basically disk transfer speeds, right? What you'll have as a bottleneck is the destination data store where you're trying to write, right? So on the consumer side, we support partitioning, and we also support partition failover through this clustering mechanism, which uses, again, Zookeeper in the back end. So those of us who use Zookeeper know how good it is with respect to, you know, holding on to these, basically these replicas and partitions, right? And even when you have partitions, for example, you can, I mean, you might wonder as to, okay, there are n number of consumers. So there is an ordered set of events happening on the producer. What happens to the same ordering? Is it maintained when it comes to any of these consumers? Right? You don't want to have in a case where updates on the same entity gets delivered to multiple consumers and then you have out of order writes. Right? We use a mechanism of basically hashing in such a way that all updates to any entity always gets delivered to the same consumer. So sequencing is maintained that way. Right? So any of the system of this kind, it can't work if you don't have consoles. So the most useful and the very basic console that we have here, I mean, I've basically mastered some of the IP addresses because this was a production console. Can't see much, I'm sorry about that. But what it shows here is basically shows a snail graph where it shows the producer, the topmost is the producer, and the bottom are all the set of consumers. So if someone, your PSEs or even or PSNEs are looking at the network, so at monitoring this system, they need to raise an alert if they start seeing divergence. And this is just simply tracking the SCNs. So the producer SCNs and the consumer change number. So it's basically saying how well the consumers are catching up. You see a single line, that's because it's all just overlaid on all of them, right? So it's like one producer and about six consumers, all of them getting overlaid. And then there you can see partition-wise, you can see how each of your consumers are doing, which partition is ahead or which partition is behind, and so on. Okay, going on to summarize what it is. Aesop is basically a PubSub-like change capture and propagation system. What it is supports multiple data stores. So we already support MySQL and HBase on the source side, and MySQL, HBase, Elasticsearch, and Kafka on the destination side. It's suitably abstracted. You can keep adding more destinations as you please. Or we also use support Redis on the destination. Some performance. So benchmarks, typically you say lies, but okay, this is a production load, so I can say with reasonable confidence. We ran. This was a data migration thing that we did when we moved the payments data store from just being MySQL into that tiered to MySQL and an HBase store. So we were moving data from the MySQL instance to HBase. So the data size was like 800 gigabytes, right? So those of us here who operate MySQL instances, you know that your ops guys will totally disown you if you say that you have databases bigger than 500 GB or so, right? So our this database had grown up to 800 GB, and we had to do something about it. So a relay running on a single Excel VM, 8 cores and 32 GB. We had 4 consumers, because I said consumer is where you'll have the bottleneck, with about 200 partitions. We achieved a throughput of 30K inserts per second, right? So the data transfer from, so if you see, it is a single threaded read of the MySQL bin log, which really is not where the bottleneck is. The bottleneck was even with 200 partitions, so the write was really on the consumer side, but with something like HBase being, I think this write we got was very high for the kind of a data store, because HBase itself is an append-only data store, right? So it's extremely fast with writes. So with that, we achieved 30K inserts, and I think this data of 800 GB, I think, got migrated over a few days, I think 2-3 days or a period of time, the data got moved. What isn't? It isn't. It's not an exactly once delivery system. It is not a storage system by itself, because barring that memory map file that it is holding on, it's not holding on to any more data. So that memory map file, we have gone to reasonably large sizes, which is I think up to 64 gigs of storing Avro serialized data, which is reasonably good for a few thousands or hundreds of thousands of events, but not for holding millions of data. There is no global ordering across different data stores, right? So if there are n number of replicas, so it is not responsible for trying to make sure that all of them are reflecting the same copy of data. So which then gets into the territory of linearizability, which clearly it isn't there. Okay, so the project itself, it's open source. It was built as open source, continues to remain open source. You can find it on GitHub. There is a support group. You can write to the users. So all engineers who contribute are right here in Bangalore, so it's quite likely that you'll get a response from one of them or from me. So you can write to us. We have multiple production deployments at Flipkart. So just to tell you, so our entire payments database, so it's super critical, obviously, right, payments. It uses Aesop. Our wish list system, so we had a use case where those of you have seen wish lists in Flipkart today, you can't share the wish list, you can't tag it, you can't allow search of wish list data and so on. The primary data store is MySQL, but when you read, the serving layer is from Elasticsearch, right? So that is live. So you can, and the intention really is tomorrow you can make it highly accessible through various free text search on top of the wish list and so on. You're trying to discover, oh, does my friend like this kind of a thing, and does he have this in his wish list? So you can execute such queries and so on. We also have used it for a complete rewrite of our promotions data store, which is running off HBase and Redis, so that's going live pretty soon. We also have our data platform, so the data platform team that you saw there, and in any data platform, when you talk about, say, dimensions and facts, so dimensions in our case are essentially entities. So you can say user is a entity, and we have events, right? So events are browse, buy, add to cart, and so on. So the events are very voluminous. They get ingested from logs and all other mechanisms. But all these entity updates, and when you're getting it from logs, obviously there can be some loss, right? So the logs getting written and so on. But the entity updates, we want them to be very, very reliable. You can't afford to lose any of those updates. And all of the entity updates currently for all user data from in Flipkart is going into the analytical data store through Aesop. I've come across even a couple of interesting use cases where one team was using it for doing a live data migration. So they created a new schema. So on the new schema, the schema change, users are accessing it. They can't bring down the system, so they keep the same data store active. Data is getting migrated, and at the same time, the new database has gone live, right? So multiple of these kind of use cases, we have started using them, and it's only growing. So whatever you see on GitHub, so the way we work, all commits go into GitHub. they get pulled and then get deployed into our production setup. So whatever you're seeing in GitHub is always ahead of the version that we have running in production. Okay, so basically that it's not like we develop it in-house and then try to push it out. So the related work, so we use the whole idea of the producer relay came from Databus, which LinkedIn created. We looked at it, we liked it, what they did, but we weren't very happy about some of the stuff that was very closely tied and in terms of how it could be managed. So we took out portions from that, when I say portions, components from it, and libraries use it within Aesop, and it still embeds. We also use other, for MySQL, we use the Open Replicator, the Google project, but we forked it for in order to support MySQL 5.6, which was a version that we are using. We also use for HBase replication, we use a project called Side Effect Processor, those of you who have known. So we use a number of other open source libraries in this as well. Very interestingly, as of May 2015, so there was a paper which came out from Facebook on a system called Wormhole. And while reading through it, I got to know that their first introduction itself said Wormhole had this problem of, in their graph search, if you're searching for one of your friends who used to live in a state X and then moved into state Y, when I say state as in, you know, a geographic state, and it takes a while before those changes propagate into this cache layer, it can be returning inconsistent data. They were okay with that, but what they wanted was something that could reliably send this data to all of their caches. So reading through, it was great, because reading through the paper, so they haven't done anything about open sourcing the system, but the paper was out there. And when we read through it, we saw that there was so much in commonality with what we were trying to do, right? Including how partitions are there, how ordering is maintained. They apply or use the same kind of log mining approach and so on. So this is, again, related work. And what's good is, even if they don't open source it, the paper has given us ideas to further enhance and probably build in this system, so that make it essentially accessible both for our own teams as well as others who might be interested. A couple of references, the paper that I said about the architecture of a database, so great read. So if any of us think, I mean, ever wondered how a database works, I would say go read that. It's not extremely technical, but very useful in terms of design. And the wormhole paper itself, you can go read through that and probably then, you know, compare it with what we do at Aesop, and you know, you can draw your own conclusions, right? So that's all I have. So this project, like I said, is open source, used in production. So if you guys are interested, go have a look. So all of the Flipkart open source projects, and I can speak because I lead our OSS initiatives, we have chosen the Apache 2 license. So you want to go and build a closer solution, you're more than welcome to do it or use it.
Any questions? So Aesop is basically a pub-sub system, right?
It's a pub-sub-like system because, yeah, the closest analogy you can see is it's like it's a pub-sub system.
Okay, so I was just wondering if there's any back pressure. So if any of the consumers are, so if it's writing to any of, let's say it's writing to Kafka, and let's say that there's a network partition, so does it affect the relay in any sense?
No. So what happens is, given that it's a ring buffer, so the events, the most recent events are what are kept in the relay, right? So if we have something called a consumer falling off the relay. So the scenarios like you said, right? So consumer is not able to catch up. So when the consumer falls off the relay, so there is something also called as a bootstrapping data store, which is nothing but another consumer which is keeping track of all of the data. So when a consumer comes back up, it can consume from the catch-up bootstrapping data store and then go into online consumption. We have done that, but what we have found more useful also is we have implemented another one called a blocking bootstrap, so which basically allows for first-time cold starting of consumers and these kind of scenarios.
Like replaying the stream, you mean? When you say cold start, you mean replaying the stream?
No, this is sometimes, suppose you want to just, like how we did the whole data migration from thing. So we have seen that sometimes the producer is so fast ahead of the consumer that it basically all consumers fall off, but they're not able to catch up. So we even have a blocking bootstrap, so you can use that as a bootstrapping mechanism.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Hey.
Yeah.
As you said, the Aesop producer is actually single-threaded, as it is tails from the log.
The replication is single-threaded.
It reads from the bin logs in a single-threaded manner.
Yes.
Can it be extended to a multi-threaded, like?
It is work. You can do it. There's nothing stopping in the producer because every producer is written independently. You can go and write it. Okay. It is doable, but then if you're doing concurrent read, so you have to do some kind of partitioning across bin logs, saying what producer. But
ordering between the partitions and
so it's, you can maintain ordering within the partitions, so you can have them push to multiple relays, so you can do that.
And how do you see we solve the challenges of partitioning and the offsets in the partition, like many threads reading?
See, it'll be very hard if you're trying to read from the same bin log, if you're trying to read using multiple consumers. So, which really means that you have multiple, think of it as you have multiple MySQL slaves, right? And then you're trying to coordinate sequencing across multiple MySQL slaves.
Okay, but if you see, as you said, key, the bottleneck is not at the producer, but it's actually at the consumer.
Yeah, so
but
you don't probably need to do it at the producer at all.
If you're seeing 10K transactions in a second, then you see the bottleneck is actually at the producer, not at the consumer, because it is single-threaded and is sending one by one at a time.
No, so we had 30K. I was telling you about 30K inserts, right? So 30K inserts. So we were still bottleneck on the consumer, not on the producer. And this was on a VM. So if you had to probably run this on a bare metal, just a producer on a bare metal, you'll probably be able to get to much higher transactions, probably 30, 40K kind of inserts per second.
Okay. Thank you.